All right, welcome everybody to the June 8th meeting of the Town of Hadley Select Board. So we're calling the meeting order just slightly after 7 o'clock. First order of business is the consent agenda. This week's consent agenda, we have the minutes from June 1st, which we're planning on postponing until June 29th. We're not quite ready yet. And then warrants 649T-2, payroll warrant 50 and 49. Do I have a motion?
So moved. Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, it passes unanimously. We have public comment period scheduled. Is there anyone in the audience this evening that would like to make public comment about something that's not on our agenda this evening otherwise? Okay. There being no public comment, then we will move right into the agenda. And we do have a couple of appointments this evening. The first one is we have an appointment with the Girl Scouts. And my understanding is that we have three Gold Award winners, which for those of you who aren't familiar with scouting is the equivalent of the Eagle Scout Award for Boy Scouts. Probably gets a little bit more press, but equally as hard to achieve and deserving of accolades for the achievement of such. Before we talk about the Gold Award recipients, we do want to acknowledge the fact that there were several Silver Award recipients from Hadley Girl Scouts this year as well. They are Monica Rosa, Jacqueline Pliska, Felicia Phil, Gabrielle Pomazano, Megan Quinlan, Haley Boisvert, Kira Cholkas, and Nicola Noonan. So congratulations to the Silver Award recipients. So tonight what we have here is we do have a proclamation from the Town of Hadley Select Board. And I'm not going to read the whole thing, but just want to acknowledge the girls individually. The first proclamation goes to Emily Keeler. And Emily, you want to stand just so? Yeah, coming up.
Come on up.
Okay.
Please.
All right, and so Emily's project to earn her Gold Award is the creation of a project, How Does Milk Get to the Store? Okay, and do you want to just briefly talk a little bit about that?
I wrote a book on how does milk get to the store, and it's about the process of the milk that until it gets to the store, and I show cows for 6 years, and kids don't understand how it gets to the store.
That's great. Okay, well, so congratulations on your achievement, Emily.
Okay. Thank you.
Great job.
Great job, Emily. Okay, and then our next recipient is Kathleen Kuzmeski. And Kathleen created a project, SASOCT, which is Suffield Academy Special Olympics, Connecticut. So, Kathleen, do you want to talk a little bit about this?
Sure. I started a club at my school with the Special Olympics, and we hold three events per year now, one in the fall, winter, and spring. my Gold Award was the cross-country race, which was in the fall, and it's now a permanent, like, annual event on their calendar. So.
Fantastic. Okay. Well, again, congratulations. And then our third and final Gold Award recipient is Aldona Noonan. Aldona, you want to come on up? And Aldona created a project, The Secrecy of Adoption. So again, you want to tell us a little bit?
Yeah, so I did a PowerPoint on adoption, and I presented it to the 7th graders at Hopkins Academy. And I'm adopted, so I picked it because it's close to me. And I just wanted to inform kids that there's a lot of us who are adopted, and so I just wanted to share it.
Great.
Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Great job.
And again, you know, scouting is quite an honor. The fact that these girls have made it this far, not only is a tribute to themselves, but also their families and their scouting leaders, because many of us who've been involved over the years know how much goes into it. So hats off to all of you as well. And then we have an additional proclamation this evening. And this one is going to be given to the Breska family. And we will read this one in its entirety. And Ken, you're here to... Okay. So whereas Ronald F. Breska has been a lifelong resident of Hadley, and whereas Ronald F. Breska graduated from Hopkins Academy in 1959 and received a Bachelor of Science degree from the University of Massachusetts in 1964, and whereas Ronald F. Breska worked for 37 years in the Hadley school system as both a teacher, a coach, and athletic director at Hopkins Academy, and whereas Ronald F. Breska had a career record of 232 wins to 149 losses during his tenure as baseball coach, and his teams won 3 Hampshire League titles, won the Western Mass and State Division III championships in 85, and as a varsity soccer coach for 6 years, his teams won 2 Hampshire League titles. And whereas Ronald F. Breska, as a coach, a teacher, has been an example to youth, adult, and elder alike, now therefore we, the Select Board of the Town of Hadley, Massachusetts, on behalf of the inhabitants, declare that June 12th, 2016, be known as Ronald F. Breska Day, given this 8th day of June in the year 2016. Say anything,
Well, on behalf of my brother, and his family, with sincere thank you for everything you people are doing here.
You and That's your family it. As well. How about, we have an event coming up this weekend, don't we?
We do, and we do on Sunday.
Yeah. On Sunday, and it's...
At the Young Men's Club Pavilion.
Yep.
Yeah, and it's a tribute to him and ALS fundraiser.
What time is it, and how can people
starting
get...
Starting at 1 o'clock.
And how can people get tickets?
They can get them now or at the door, it'll be fine.
I know sure. Caterers usually like to have the number in advance, right?
I usually do.
I've heard that.
I usually do. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ken.
Okay. So we have another scheduled appointment at 7:30, but we can get a few other things done in the interim, I think. So why don't we just skip ahead on the agenda? And go to the North Hadley Village Hall sale of real estate. We'll skip over that one for now because we don't have a full complement. The Hadley Go Green Committee. This was a follow-up item. Our Select Board member Donald Pachinski had proposed to establish a Hadley Go Green Committee, and we asked to provide some additional information to us for consideration.
Okay. With Mr. Devine's request last week, he said this would probably fall under the Board of Health. So I went to the Board of Health, and last night they voted to adopt the stewardship of this committee, and this committee would report to them. This is a task force mission. The committee will set their own mission, but this gives you an idea what we're talking about. The mission of the Green Hadley Task Force is to empower, encourage the town of Hadley and its residents and institutions to use resources efficiently with an eye toward long-term sustainability and stewardship of our local and global environment. I guess the key word there is sustainable. Sustainable development means meeting the needs of the present without compromising the ability of the future generations to meet our own needs. Preserving our civilization and the things we hold dear in perpetuity while enhancing our quality of life. Environmentally sound, economically productive, and socially just. So basically, they would be looking into things like maybe a ban on plastic bags, styrofoam, green issues, solar issues, and everything would be only recommending their ad hoc committee, and anything would be recommended to the Board of Health for their review, and if they feel it's something worthwhile, they would submit it to the Board of Selectmen in the future. I think that's it.
Okay. So any questions or comments for Mr. Bibchinski? Yours? No? No? Okay, so would the board like to, anyone want to make a motion to move forward with this, or is there any further discussion needed? David?
So is this a committee of the select board, or is it a committee of the Board of Health?
Board of
Health.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So the only thing we would be doing would be just indicating that we're fine with it, but really ultimately it's the Board of Health to adopt the committee.
Thank you for
Do we even need a vote for that?
No, if it's the Board of Health appointment, then they take it on themselves. You can vote to endorse the idea and express your willingness to work cooperatively and in collaboration with the Board of Health on these issues.
So would somebody like to make that motion? Or?
I'll make a motion to support the Hadley Task Force for Green Hadley.
Second.
Okay. Any further discussion? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. All right. Thanks, Donald.
Thank you.
Okay. So if we can, let's go back then to North Hadley Village Hall. Now that Mr. Ruskevitz is here. Okay, so David, you
want to
bring us up to speed, or?
Okay, so we had two bids submitted for the sale of North Hadley Village Hall. The first bid was for Mr. Joel Greenbaum, Historic Renovations and Rental Properties Limited, and his proposed price was $73,000. There was one other bid that was from the North Hadley Congregational Church, and that bid price was $2,500. Meeting with Mr. Greenbaum, in order to clarify the bid, there were four options that were available in the RFP, and he selected the option two. That's what his proposal is for. Now, option two is the sale of the building and the grounds of the building, as well as a sliver of the property just to the north of the building, allowing the town to retain the property south of the Congregational Church and all the way from River Drive down to the shoreline, or along the property boundaries in any case. Further talking with Mr. Greenbaum, he understands that there's a committee that is looking at a proposed North Hadley Village fire station or substation on that property that the town would retain. He's willing to negotiate with the town where that property line would be. He requires 50 feet of the property from the North Hadley Village Hall itself. So whatever is left over from a 50-foot carve out, that would be for the fire station. He's willing to take his time with this. He understands the committee needs time to put their proposals together and to present their information to the budgetary process and then ultimately to town meeting, recognizing that town meeting is scheduled for October 27th. Mr. Greenbaum is comfortable with the board taking a vote on the proposal to award his bid tonight, and then we would sign the purchase and sale agreement after more things are clarified in November 2016. He's comfortable with that time frame.
Okay. Anybody from the negotiating committee have anything to?
No, I think he was pretty much up front with allowing, you know, a time frame there, and very cooperative and willing to work with the town. So I'm going to make a motion to award the sale of the North Hadley Hall to Mr. Greenbaum, option two.
Okay. Is there a second on the motion?
Second.
Okay. Any further discussion on that?
Just a friendly amendment to the motion would be that we would work cooperatively with Mr. Greenbaum in order to obtain whatever permits are needed. Both parcels will need a special permit from or a variance from the Zoning Board of Appeals, so we would support each other in that endeavor.
Okay.
I guess my only question would be, when we're voting this, are we voting the 72,000 figure, or has there been negotiations reduced because we've been taking some of the land away from the original bid?
Stays at 72.
Stays at 72. Okay.
Can't change the scope of the bid after the bid's been opened, so okay. 72.
Okay. Any further discussion on the board? No. Question, John?
Yeah, that north boundary is going to be 50 feet from the building?
That's what he would require.
Right, he has to have that for parking.
Yep.
Okay. All right, no further discussion?
I got one comment on the parking. Maybe in the negotiation process, talking with him, he owns directly across the street an empty lot of almost a half acre, which could be additional parking. Are working with him maybe if we need additional land for this proposed fire station. So maybe it'd be something for discussion purposes only.
Okay.
It's just discussion. I'm not saying to change anything.
No, you're just offering the information to the negotiating.
Yeah, so he may enter into some discussion there. Mm-hmm. You know, I think when we talk with him, we're talking shared parking. You know, and maybe inviting the church in also on the other end, maybe talking with them for some type of shared parking to get them off the main Route 47. They park out there all the time, nights and Sundays, and it's a very dangerous situation. So if we could alleviate some of that problem for the church at the same time, it'd benefit everyone.
They're actually lined up on a sidewalk on both sides of the road during the church.
Okay. So Joyce and Jerry, you
okay.
Just continue to stay the course on this. David, you want to?
Just so for information, because we're selling this property for less than the assessed value, we are going to have to put a notice in the Central Register justifying why we went with the lower value for the property.
Okay. All right. Okay. Well, no further question. Do you have your hand up?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
Would the board also agree to forward this to for a hearing with the ZBA, both for Mr. Greenbaum and for the rest of the site, because they're both going to need variances?
That's what we said, John.
That's going to happen at the same time?
Yes.
So we can set
we
up a
hearing?
We said
we would work in conjunction with the ZBA for both.
So we can set up a hearing as soon as possible?
As soon as Mr. Greenbaum... As soon as we
chooses
make a deal to, or he chooses to, yes.
Yeah, he's
all. We said we would work with him on it.
Mr. Michkowski, I think we have to wait for your committee to actually come up with a proposal so that we can go to the Zoning Board of Appeals and talk about
right.
What is it exactly that we're proposing to put on
exactly.
That property.
Okay, so we have a motion made and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, unanimous. All right, so we still have another 10 minutes before our 7:30 scheduled appointment. I was just going
to. I'm sorry.
No, that's good. You're very helpful. So we're going to go through the use of the town common. This came up at a previous meeting. There was a suggestion that perhaps Town of Hadley should consider establishing a fee for the use of the West Street Common. And one proposal was to allow Hadley residents free use of the common and then charge non-residents a fee and not-for-profit, with not-for-profit events being charged a reduced fee compared to a for-profit event, which would be charged a higher amount. The figures we discussed last time were $100 for not-for-profit, $250 for for-profit. But private events for Hadley residents, such as weddings, would be free of a use charge. So I think we had asked for further information, and Jennifer, did you get the information?
I did. I attached on to board docs for everyone, and Donna, you have a paper copy. I researched and found, I looked at the town of Montague, like Jerry had suggested.
Mm-hmm.
I also looked at Amherst. They both do charge. They are, Montague is a little bit lower, but they also have a deposit that they require if you don't clean the space up. They charge you, you don't get your deposit back to clean up.
Mm-hmm.
Amherst does the same thing with an additional charge of a deposit for leaving the commons is how you found it.
Mm-hmm. I'm all for adding that part of it.
Absolutely.
Yeah, you know.
Yep. And that would be in addition to the permit fee, mm-hmm. or the use of land fee. But it does seem to be common practice for other towns to charge a fee for use of the permit or use of the commons. We would be the only one where I see doing a for-profit, non-profit, or for residents or not for residents.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that it would be appropriate.
Okay. And I've received feedback that our proposed price of $250 for a profit event is too low. So mm-hmm. I've heard prices going from $750 up to $1,000.
And who would be charged with enforcing the fees? It'd be going through the selectman's office?
Yeah, this is
the permit now, so yeah.
use of any town property has to be approved by the select board.
Okay. The only thing I was just thinking about afterwards was, are we going to run into some sort of issue trying to police who's a resident, non-resident? Somebody's a resident, they get the permit at the reduced fee, but it's actually somebody else running the event. I mean, do we need to, I hope we don't get into splitting hairs on some of these things and chasing people.
Yeah, if it gets to a point where we need a Philadelphia lawyer to figure this stuff out, we'll bring it back to the board and ask you to make a revision.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So you said the fee was too low. Are you proposing a higher one, David? Maybe $500, or what were you thinking?
Well, I said at our last meeting that we should start slow and move, find the right size later on. We had suggested $250 to begin with. I'm comfortable with going to $500.
So moved.
Okay, there's a motion on the floor. Does someone want a second? Second for discussion?
Yes.
Tim?
You know, we have two sides of the common. How about if somebody used the entire thing, compare it to a section or something like that? Maybe it could be different based on the amount of space that they use.
So
I mean, just a suggestion.
You mean like the Asparagus Festival where the event occurred,
right,
on half of it, but then they took up the entire rest of it with parking?
Well, that's the entire common.
Yeah.
That would be a full fee, but if somebody was just doing something that was smaller,
mm-hmm.
and it only dealt with a portion of it, maybe it could be a little bit smaller.
So maybe $500 for the whole thing, $250 for one side or the other?
Something like that.
We had talked, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I have noticed several times in the past, reading in the paper about the problem Amherst has with their common when they have carnivals and it rains,
mm-hmm.
and what happens in terms of maintenance of the grass and
yeah.
the mud and that. And are you going to have any provision for, I mean, leaving it like you found it, except for act of nature? I mean, what happens there? Because that is a big expense for DPW.
Right. I mean, I think it's something that, to your point, I would imagine the language would read that it needs to be left in the same manner that you found it. But we all know that if you have parking involved and it's raining outside, it's not going to be left that way.
But I still think that all of these functions need to come before the board anyway. So we would still be in control of what is the common is used for and if we grant the license.
Yeah, that's a good point.
So I don't think that we're planning on any Ferris wheels and carnival being on the town common
mm-hmm.
any too soon at this point. I'm going to start a little bit slower than that and just, you know, have different things, but I don't think that is going to happen. Not my
yeah, no, it's a good point because we do review all the details. Mm-hmm. Thank you. John?
Is there going to be side costs, police, cleanup, all that?
They
already, yeah.
Listed in there?
Yes.
In addition to
damages?
Yes.
Right, this is an addition, an add-on fee that we're not charging currently. It's a use fee.
They would have to have proper insurance and all that kind of stuff. So.
As they do now.
Right, so this wouldn't supersede any practices or policies we have in place. This is just merely adding on a usage fee. Okay.
They'd have to work under the direction of the chief of police and any order and conditions from public safety or building inspections or public works.
So, Joyce, do you want to be specific in your motion in terms of the monetary? I mean, are we doing profit, non-profit, resident, non-resident, the
yes.
way it's laid out here?
Yes. I'll make a motion as stated to do resident for free, nonprofit for free profit for $500, still with all the people coming before the board presenting their projects to the board.
Nonprofit was still $100.
Still $100.
Oh, still
$100.
Okay.
Okay. Are we doing $500 for the whole thing, $250 for half? Or are we doing?
I kind of like that idea.
I recommend against any kind of
division. I don't think so.
Yeah, if you try to put together some sort of dimensional estimate here, then it encourages people to lowball either space they need or number of attendees or something like that.
Okay, so $500 for the whole thing.
I guess for discussion purposes, I rode by there during the event, and I've got to commend the two officers that were directing traffic. I even bought them both a bottle of water to drink. They were sweating, and I don't know how they handled traffic coming in both directions, and people were crossing both ways, sometimes 75 to 100 people at a time, and I don't know, it looked to me like a disaster ready to happen, and I don't know if the chief would recommend not allowing that to happen again from both sides parking and keep everything on one side, but it was really dangerous.
I would love to see that. The problem is with the volume of people that were coming to that event and some of the other ones that we have, there's just no other way of doing it, which is why we required extra officers this time. And it was crazy. It was a lot. My question was going to be, are you going to add any of the damage, John brought it up, any of the damage assessments to everyone, including in-town folks? You know, they don't get the fee, the common, but, you know, any of the damages.
That's a very good idea to put that on there for everyone.
Because.
Their licensing, mm-hmm. Yes.
I think there was initial talk about requiring a deposit.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe we should discuss how much of a deposit they would have to put up, and then we would return the deposit to them if it was in satisfactory condition.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd like to add that DPW would be the one to assess whether or not the damage, if it was damaged or left in a poor condition, because they're the ones that are going to spot it
mm-hmm.
more readily than I am. If I'm out there, I think that they'll notice that things have been torn up more than I might, since they're the ones that maintain it.
What is the number that the other towns are using for a deposit?
Amherst is requiring $250 for Kendrick Park.
How much is the deposit against the damage?
That is the deposit for the
okay.
damage is $250. And it requires them to have insurance as well.
What about the common itself? Kendrick Park is a very, very small area.
For the commons, they did not have listed what the deposit was for their commons. Let me just double check that as I say that. It was not on their permit for their commons, which is what I printed and looked at.
Mm-hmm.
But I did read it. Even though Kendrick Park is small, they rent it out frequently.
Right.
So that was what I was just looking at. I mean, you could make the deposit a $500 deposit as well. If we're talking about the assessing damages.
How about Montague? What do they use?
Montague is Montague's is on the board docs, and my board docs are not connected up.
I didn't see a deposit on theirs. On Montague's. I guess I missed it.
Yeah, I don't see a deposit there.
Okay.
I see a fee, but not a deposit.
It's just Amherst that charges deposit.
So should we start again? This is subject to review, but just to get it rolling, should we call for a $250 deposit, $500 fee?
No, the Montague one's got attached copy of your insurance policy or liability binder. Minimum policy, $1 million, individual, $3 million.
Right, we have
rest,
that already.
Right.
We're just talking about the fee.
Well,
we don't have the fee.
For cleanup.
That's for liability purposes.
So that's if there's damage to the property, so if the common was damaged.
No, we'll still have that.
No, we're talking about people leaving trash.
We'll still have that exactly like that is there, and ours would include it, but the damage.
That's what I'm saying, the damage would be covered under that policy.
How about if you leave trash on the common?
Well, not the trash part, but if there's.
That's what we're talking about, the trash.
Physical damage on the property.
Yeah.
We're talking about the trash.
I'd make a motion to set it at 500 temporarily, but we could always change it later. If it's, you know, for everyone, nonprofit, residents, one set fee for everyone, and then they're going to get it back if there's no damage, so it shouldn't be any problem putting that money up.
Choose that as a friendly amendment, add it to Joyce's amendment.
Yeah.
I'd second that.
You'll second that? Okay. Any further discussion on this? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, so it's 7:30, so we do have a scheduled 7:30 appointment with Good Energy. I believe John O'Rourke is with us this evening.
Thank you, Madam Chairwoman.
You're welcome.
Welcome back. Thank you, members of the board, for allowing me to appear before you tonight. I have just a short status of where aggregation is here in Massachusetts.
Excellent.
I know your board is very knowledgeable about aggregation based on your past experience. And I'll just go over this briefly and then we can open it up to questions. This first slide shows where the number of households in aggregation and municipal light departments. In Massachusetts, there are 47 municipalities that have what are known as municipal light plants or municipal light departments. Those towns either purchase or generate and or generate some of their own electricity. You can see on the chart, I've numbered our competitors as number one and two. That second bar is the Cape Light Compact. They were the first aggregation to come online in Massachusetts back in about 2002. You can see Good Energy is bar four. We have a little over 200,000 households in aggregation as of this year. And the MLPs, you can see they have about 318 households in and they are considered aggregations. So right now, you have about 34% of your households in Massachusetts are receiving their supply either from an aggregation or from a municipal light plant. The next slide basically shows what we're expecting to happen in 2017. We will surpass the number of households that municipal light plants have. We will be up to about 400 and a little over 450,000 households. That brings the total of households that are being supplied by other than the local utility up to about 48%. On that next chart, you can see the history of how aggregation has progressed here in Massachusetts. In 2002, that's the Cape Light Compact. Things stayed static until about 2007. Marlboro came online then, and then that stayed static until about 2012. There were a couple of more aggregations that came online. And starting in 2014, you can see how the progress has rapidly increased. We're expecting that next year there'll be about 900,000 households in aggregation. On that last slide, these are the number of households in aggregation from our company, Good Energy, as well as our two competitors who practice here in Massachusetts. And essentially, I just wanted to give you the flavor of how this has progressed over the last, especially the last 3 years. And we're expecting that probably by the year 2020, there'll be over 80% of the households in Massachusetts will be in aggregation of some sort. I'll open it up to questions.
is for the interest of everybody that's watching and that's available here. The aggregation, if you could just start with a square one and explain to us what it would be.
Okay. Essentially, what we do, we aggregate the electricity load of municipalities. That's the residents and businesses in the municipality who are not on already on a competitive supplier. You're all familiar with offers that come in the mail or online. You might get phone calls, you might get knocks on your door. Those are people who are basically selling programs to people here in Massachusetts who may not want to buy their electricity from the local utility, either Eversource or National Grid. Some of those programs are very legitimate. A lot of them aren't. A lot of them have very high termination fees. And some of them have a teaser rate up front that is followed by very high rates later on. What we do is we take the whole town together. We go out to bid. We take the buying power of that whole town. And essentially, as I say, right now we have about 215,000 households in aggregation. That's a tremendous buying power. When you go out to bid for a competitive supplier, many of the larger companies today are very interested in getting into the residential market on the scale that we bring them as an aggregator, rather than try to get one customer at a time. Obviously, the acquisition cost trying to get one customer at a time is much higher than if you didn't lump a whole town or a group of towns together in an aggregation. And this is essentially what we try to do. And as I say, since the volatility in rates has increased over the last couple of years, there's been tremendous increase in the number of municipalities who have wanted to go to aggregation. We recently won the bid for the Massachusetts, for the Metropolitan Area Planning Council for their 101 municipalities that are around Boston. We're dealing with many of those communities now who want to come online with either a normal type aggregation or an aggregation that puts additional green energy into the mix. As I say, there are a number of, we're dealing with a number of communities. At this point, we expect to put on over 200,000 more households in 2017.
But so you're going out and buying power and you're using the municipality. Anybody in the municipality which wishes to sign up for this, there's no strong arm, you don't have to do this. There's an out under any circumstances, and the contract can be canceled for any circumstances. You would be simply going out and achieving the best price available for the citizens of Hadley to buy their energy cheaper than they currently buy it today.
Yes. As the law exists, and the law is Massachusetts General Law, Chapter 164, Section 134A, which governs municipal aggregation. It's an opt-out program, which essentially means that everyone, once the town decides they want to do an aggregation, everyone who is on the basic service of the utility would be included in the program, and they get an opt-out letter. They get a letter explaining the program. They have a 30-day period to opt out of that by law. Our programs, you can opt out anytime without a penalty. The reason for the opt-out program and the way the law was written, because that's the way you get the largest buying group and the best way to get the best price for your residents. The law was initiated and written by Senate President Stan Rosenberg. And he thought when he originated the law, the best way to do it was through the best organizing force in any municipality, which is the town or city government. And the fact that it's an opt-out program gives you the largest buying group. And again, from that, any resident or business who comes into the program can get out of the program anytime without penalty. But the whole idea of the program is to bulk buy, to combine the purchasing power of all the residents, and again, within a town or among a number of towns, to go out and to purchase electricity. Gives them a much better position for bargaining for a lower price.
I have a multitude of questions. Okay. Let me start first by, did you ever work for Hampshire Energy?
I did.
Were you part of the process where they lost $860,000?
I left before that happened.
So did I. I was on the Energy Committee and I left 3 years, so I'm very aware of this. My next question is, what is your rate? What are you proposing the rate for us presently?
Well, right now, you wouldn't be ready to go out to bid for a competitive rate until October, because we have to go through a very strict process with the Department of Energy Resources and the Department of Public Utilities. We write the plan, we put the plan through that process, and once that plan is approved by the Department of Public Utilities, then we go out to bid, and whatever that rate is.
Then I would like a projected rate for October.
If I could tell you what the projected rate for October was now, I'd be in the Bahamas.
Okay, then I guess I'm going to tell you some rates.
Okay.
Eversource Electric is 10.43 right now, okay? And if you opt out of Eversource right now and took Constellation, which anybody that's on Eversource can do right now, they can opt out of Eversource and go right into Constellation, they will give you a fixed rate of 9.99, fixed for 24 months. This is what I got to know. If you're going to compare with that, can you beat that? Or you're going to be higher? The second thing is no interruption in service from this transfer. Sign-up fees from Constellation and new equipment, if it's needed, absolutely no cost. Eversource will deliver your electric bill to you the same way you're getting it now if you go to Constellation. And they'll also give you a $25 bonus gift certificate for signing up. So I guess what I'm looking for you, what are you going to do more than what Constellation would do? You haven't told me anything yet.
Okay. Constellation also has a termination fee of $150 if you look closely. Their programs are not as popular as other programs like Con Ed Solutions or Think Energy, which have lower rates and don't have termination fees. We compete very successfully with both Con Ed Solutions and Think Energy on their rates.
John, could I ask, just as a follow-up
sure.
to Mr. Pipchinski's question,
mm-hmm.
in the way your program's working, if the town were to adopt this aggregation program, there's an automatic enrollment.
Yes.
And as Mr. Devine pointed out, there is an opt-out. So if anybody did not want to participate in your program, they could opt out.
That's correct.
And in opting out, they then have another spate of options that they could sell, whether it's solar or anything else.
Absolutely.
So by if we were to enter into an agreement with you, that would not preclude somebody from shopping elsewhere if they could find a better rate and opting out. Is that correct?
Not at all. No, not at all. We go through a very very thorough public outreach and education and marketing program before this happens, so that when we're ready to go out to bid and customers get customer notification letters that say, here's the rate for the public utility, here's the rate for the aggregation. It comes with a postcard. If for some reason they don't want to go in the front, they sign the postcard, send it in, and they're out.
Mm-hmm.
That's the way that works.
And then they just stay with the service that they have?
Yes.
Or
yes.
Sign up for something else.
Exactly.
Right. I mean, they don't have
if
to.
I understand correctly, though, the whole town has to opt in the beginning. And then they have to opt out, but everybody goes in the beginning.
Everybody who is on the basic service, which at this point in time is considered a last resort service by the Department of Public Utilities, everybody on that basic service is automatically in, or they get a letter that they can be in. They have a 30-day opt-out period, okay? They're not switched during that period. During that period, they have an option of saying, yes, I want to go with the program, no, I don't want to go with the program.
I have a tough time voting for this because you can't give me a rate. You know, your rate could be 2 or 3 cents higher when it comes to October than what they have. And if you can't commit a rate, how do you expect us to vote for this?
Well, essentially, all you're doing by going and voting for this program is going through a research process. You're going to the Department of Public Utilities and the Department of Energy Resources, who look at the plan very carefully. Once they approve the plan, okay, we can get all the way up to bid day, okay, for the competitive bid. And what happens on bid day, you get a matrix of choices. You get term, you get from 12, 18, 24, 30 months, and you get, you, if you want, you should get a bigger slice of green over the RPS requirement at this point, which is 11%, if you wanted to do that.
But same that's, with Constellation. And, it costs you more money for green energy.
Right, and there's a number of suppliers who will bid for your account.
I guess that leads me to another question. What are your current customers' rate? You should know that.
We have our current customers went in at 949.
For how long a period? 2 years?
2 years.
Fixed?
Fixed.
Okay, so then that's
now,
like
they
a
also
half
they
a
also had
less.
A choice of doing a 1 year at 8.8, but what they wanted to do, they wanted longer term fixed rates. And what's going to start to happen next year in this next winter rate, capacity charges are going up because there are so many plants coming offline, the older coal plants and some of the oil plants, and there's not and the capacity charge is going to go up significantly. That's going to cause a problem in the next two winters for rates. So our rate, and again, over that two-year period, we're going to save these people substantial funds.
But we don't know that till October. And that rate could increase significantly by October.
Which rate are we talking
about? The one you're talking about, your proposed rate.
Our rate is fixed for that, for the aggregations that we have now. That two-year contract is fixed.
But ours wouldn't be. Ours, you wouldn't have a rate for us till October if we opt in on this grant.
You don't find out what your rate is till you go out to a competitive bid.
It's kind of a dangerous situation in my mind.
John, I think the question that I'm hearing Donald asking, is there any risk that what people are currently paying with Eversource now for a base rate, whatever you're calling, whatever we're, for those people who are
it's
with
called,
Eversource.
It's called basic service.
Basic services,
yes,
with
yeah.
Eversource.
Yeah.
Is there a risk that we would sign an agreement with you and then we would be locking ourselves into a rate that's higher than what Eversource is paying, unless, of course, the entire industry cost has gone up? So
when you sign up with us, all we're doing for you, okay, we're taking everything through the process of the legal process with the Department of Energy Resources and the Department of Public Utilities. We're doing the outreach and the public education for your residents. We're doing the competitive bid, and again, we are a national organization, so we have relationships with many of the national suppliers to bring them into the bid process. Once that is, you know, if we can get the bid day, and if for some reason you don't like the bid, you say, we're not
no,
going to do it now.
Okay. We're going to wait until we get a better rate.
That's right. That's our business risk.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We've got to come to you with a better rate than the basic rate, or you're not going to accept it.
Right. Okay. I just wanted to make it sure it was clear that
oh,
that
yeah.
was the case.
No. That's the way it works.
Who's doing your billing? Is Eversource doing your billing, or us?
The only thing that changes with the bill is the one line that says the supplier is now ABC Electric.
But we'll still be getting the bill from Eversource.
Everything else stays the same. Eversource takes care of the billing. Eversource takes care of all of the maintenance of the infrastructure. If there are power outages, Eversource is the one that takes care of it. The only thing you're doing is you're making a choice of supplier. That's the only difference.
Question in the back.
Yes,
Jane?
I have two questions. One is, when I look at my electric bill now, there's a supplier cost, and then I don't know what they call it, an administrative cost.
Distribution.
So that would still be Eversource's charge.
Yes.
Separate from yours.
That's correct.
My second question is, as a homeowner with solar on my roof, who would be buying that from me? You, the supplier, or Eversource?
You have solar now?
Yes.
Do you have a net metering contract?
Yes.
You do? Okay. That's unaffected. You just would have less, use less electricity from your, you know, the supplier.
Any additional questions for Mr. David? Sorry?
Just a little bit of context. We've already entered in as a government with a regional supplier of electricity for a fixed cost for the next 3.5 years. And mm-hmm. So we've been doing aggregate purchasing of electricity as a town government for many years, and it saved us tens of thousands of dollars. Mm-hmm. So this is an opportunity to extend that same opportunity to the individual homeowners so that they're not buying electricity as a single household, but they're aggregating their purchasing power in order to collectively achieve a lower rate.
And town meeting voted?
Town meeting voted back in 2005 to authorize the selectmen to pursue this concept. We did pursue this concept through a regional supplier. We all know that didn't work out, so we turned to Good Energy to see if we couldn't restart that process. We've done our background research on Good Energy. It's a reputable firm. They do what they promise. And so I think that this is a good opportunity. We also have our net metering credit agreements with NextAmp. So the municipal aggregate electricity purchasing and the net metering credit agreements would be unaffected by this opportunity. We're just allowing the homeowners out in TV land to have an opportunity to get a cheaper electricity bill.
Okay. Any other select board members have questions?
It's in here pretty clear. It's about 10% on the Eversource bill right now, roughly.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to make a motion to...
Can I ask one more question?
I'm making a motion first. Making a motion to accept Good Energy, give them the authority to enter into
bid out
for the energy power process for Hadley.
Okay. Second, I'm Joyce.
Second for discussion.
Okay, second for discussion.
I guess I want to know who is our municipal contract with now.
Hampshire Town Council of Governments.
Okay, and they wanted to do the same thing he's doing, and they failed at the state level.
Mm-hmm.
And so you said you looked at other companies, and they're the best one out there. How did you arrive at Good Energy versus everybody else that's out there?
Mr. O'Rourke has been kind enough to talk to me in the past. I said that we weren't in a position to do business with him because we had this opportunity through the HCOG. HCOG couldn't deliver the package at the end. They did introduce us to a company called Colonial Power. We had a presentation from them.
Yeah.
We looked into them, and for a number of reasons, we decided that Good Energy, given their track record and their recommendations, their references that checked out, that was the better company to deal with.
Why couldn't we enter into a bid process and have everybody submit to us, and then we'll just pick the lowest one instead of granting him carte blanche?
That's a technical process that we are ill-equipped to undertake. You would need to hire a technical expert, and I am not that expert.
Okay. We have a question in the back of the room. John?
Yeah. The commercial rate and the residential rate are different or the same?
We go out with a residential rate, okay. Any small business that's wants to come on to the program can do it at the rate that we get. Your larger commercial rates are different, okay. Like your town rate is different because your town rate is rated a G2 instead of an R1. Okay, so there are different rates involved, but our rate is a single rate.
So small mom-and-pop business would pay the same residential as residential?
That's correct.
Now, people that are locked in for a year, would with another company besides Eversource, what happens to that?
Well, if at the time the program is started, there are people who are with a competitive supplier, okay, when their contract ends, if they want to join the aggregation, they can do that.
All right, so we have a motion made and seconded. Any further discussion on this? Okay, if no, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Any opposed?
No.
Opposed?
Opposed, yes.
Okay. So four to one? All right, thank you, Mr. O'Rourke.
Thank you, Madam Chairman, members of the board. Any questions? David has my number. Please don't hesitate to call me.
Okay.
Have a good night.
Right,
thank
you, too.
You.
Take care. All right, I think the vast majority of the audience is here for new business items tonight, which are the Goodman Memorial Library, Senior Center, the Municipal Building Committee, and then also an interest in the committee appointments as well. So should we take the well, I'm wondering if we should do that or wait until they're done with the conversation and then go back to the appointments. I think I'd rather do it that way. Okay. So Goodwin Memorial Library. Basically, just to put this in context, we were hoping to get an update from the folks at the library, also the Senior Center, and then Municipal Building Committee pulling it together, just on where people stand with their various initiatives. Thought it would be a good idea to have everybody in the same room at the same time, too, that might be helpful. So, did you want to say something?
I'm sorry?
Did you want to say something?
Nope.
Oh, okay. You had that funny look on your face.
No.
So library, do you want to just provide an update to everybody?
I'll start. I'm sure Joanne will pitch in. So everybody has probably seen now the results of the survey that we put out to the community about the articles that were on town meeting floor.
Let's not assume
okay.
that.
Okay. Okay. Sorry, I was under the impression that you all had copies of it.
We may, but
okay. So anyway, so we read through all those, took a lot of time discussing it on the planning and design meeting committee met on Monday night. And so as a result of sort of all the information that we've collected, we are the planning and design committee, which is not the same as the trustees, we're a subcommittee, voted to explore two additional sites, including the field behind the current Hooker School and the land between Hopkins and Russell School. We had a member of the school committee, Linda Dunleavy, was there on Monday, and she was expressing support for us looking at the site between Russell and Hopkins. Hopefully to make a partnership. She saw some real overlap between some of the programming that they have and some of the programming that we do. So we know that there are some considerations for that site, including we don't know what the limits of the floodplain are. The site was originally not chosen, partially because we didn't know where the floodplain was, and this was in consultation with the building committee, and I'm sure David would have more to say about this than myself. And we, our architect did not think there was sufficient space to have the building of the size that we would need for our program and enough parking, so we were required to have a certain amount of parking. So one of the things that Linda said to us is that part of their plan for the fields was already a renovation and expansion of their parking. And so maybe this would be an opportunity for us to partner with them on that. You know, so we do have a grant that's going to pay for our parking, and so maybe this could be a good partnership. So we have authorized our architect to work with their civil engineer to take a look at the viability of the land in terms of floodplain and what it would mean. So that's where we are now. So that's only the recommendation from the Planning and Design Committee. The Library Trustees meet next Tuesday, and then we'll have to take a vote on those same things, have the same discussion. But we are also hoping that part of what we will get tonight is more information on because we know that, you know, in the meantime, the senior center are moving ahead with their plans to have a new building, and the building committee folks have been meeting regularly. So we don't know if there are other planned uses for either of those sites, so we would love to hear about it before we went much further. If nothing else, this is a good thing for the town, because our architect will be doing a lot of investigation of that parcel of land, so if it's ever going to be used for any municipal purpose, we'll at least have that information in our pocket that will become, you know, part of our information for the town. So we figured this was, you know, a good win all around to start that investigation.
Okay. Any questions for the folks at the library and where they stand? Or the information that Allison provided?
I guess the only question I would have, maybe in your discussion with your architect, maybe they could include Russell School too with the parking, because we're going to have to make some major decisions with that building. Either we sell it or renovate it, and it's in dire need of parking also. So if it could be encompassed maybe in between where the little ball field is, some type of design for additional parking for Russell School at the same time.
So then, so what you're suggesting, just trying to get it clear, is if we, our building was sited, the building itself, closer to Hopkins, and then the parking would be located between Russell and the new building.
And the backside, the academy needs additional parking also.
Okay.
So it could work for three or four different departments the same time if you're going to do a design. Encompass the whole thing.
Right, and we have not seen yet of which parts of the land are in the floodplain. Again, this is more David than myself, but, you know, so we really don't know what's feasible at this point, but that's certainly, you know, something that we can discuss with them as we move further, if that's even viable.
I think you'd also need to be careful too, because the monies that were allocated were specific to the library.
Well, yes.
Right, so I mean, right. I think we just want to be careful if not crossing over.
No, I'm not saying, you know, when you do a design, you don't have to include that in their money. But how it would look if we retained a portion of that land for Russell School.
I see.
They would incorporate it.
Okay.
I'm not saying you're going to pay for it with the library or anything, just the overall picture of design.
I see.
Yeah.
So you weren't talking about putting parking where it could potentially be used for other, you were talking about potentially not using part of the land in case a parking, additional parking spaces for Russell School were needed in the future.
I don't know how much land you would need for the library, but everybody needs parking there.
Right.
And if you have X amount of land and you have additional space, it could be utilized parking for Hopkins Academy and Russell School.
I also think that if this pans out in any way, there'll be lots of meetings and lots of discussion before we go further. First, we're just investigating about building in the floodplain.
Right.
And so then there'll be lots of talk about if that's a viable option, then
I think it'll be a large buffer anyway between Russell School and your building, because the main duct for the state drain goes right down through the middle of the ball field all the way out to the river south. So there's going to be quite a buffer that you could possibly put a parking lot in between the two buildings, wherever it might be built, you know.
Okay. Dave?
I just say that our committee would also encourage the library groups to look at that property. Our initial research indicated that it is within the floodplain, and as such would require compensatory flood mitigation, meaning that we're filling part of the floodplain. We have to provide additional floodplain storage elsewhere in town, which is a big challenge. But we have not had a civil engineer do any specific search of that delineation. I believe the markers are on the building.
Yes, they are. The national marker is on the building, so any type of survey for elevation regarding the floodplain would be pretty easy to do, since the marker is right there. It is something that we should have done a number of years ago, and which our municipal building committee did take upon getting the surveys done. But that's been discussed so many times, and it's too bad that we're still guessing where that is. It is not that deep, but It is shown on the map as in the floodplain, but it is something that, you know, it's done by photography and not by actual measurement.
Yes.
So really, I mean, it's something we should do immediately to get this discussion going.
So our architect has been, is going to go out and do that. And I agree with Allison. I mean, we thought even if we don't move there, it's a good use of our money for the town to have this information.
Remember, we have the survey. We just did the survey.
Okay.
So you can contact us,
okay,
and we can PDF that over
get
to whoever's doing
tell,
that.
Right.
And that's a great start.
As John indicated, I'd also encourage the library and their civil engineering team to make sure that the stormwater sewer line is shown on that, because that is a challenge for that site. If it crosses the ball field,
okay,
it's going to be difficult to site a building one side or the other of that utility.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So, Allison, you get that?
Yep, I got all that information. And so the Stu's hope is that he would have information available for us at our next meeting, which is June 27th. So we have to fast track this because we don't have a lot of time for ourselves to come up with a new plan. So he knows this. And so ideally, we'll all be getting information sooner rather than later.
Got it.
Okay.
I'll start with the library, and we'll move on to Council on Aging.
Okay.
Can everybody hear me back here?
Okay.
So I know everybody's hinged and dovetailed on each other. Our process to this point has been limited by what our committee could do because we're still waiting for information on land. The RFPs that were reissued don't come in until July 26th. So we can't really have a conference, and we don't have an owner's project manager yet picked for the town to move forward in any of those ways. So we've been very limited in so far as picking a place and moving forward with feasibility in those particular issues, and we're looking for input and help on that front.
Mm-hmm.
On the other side of the spectrum, we have made, I think, some really significant progress in honing down exactly what we've made 5 site visits to different senior centers so far. And I'm happy to say that the cost estimates that David Tudrin came up with that square footage that we had talked about initially, which is a 10,000 square foot building with the 30% added on for, you know, mechanical hallways and all the rest of that, does come in at that price range. Also, even though some of the senior centers that we went to go look at were twice the size, they came in at twice the cost. That tells us it's feasible to do the size of the building that we want at that cost, which is a good thing to know. It's kind of like a, okay, that's not going to be, so far, a big, big, big problem. In looking at some of the other senior centers that we've gone to, we've gotten vast amounts of feedback from the directors and people there about what worked, what didn't work, what we liked, what we didn't like. Things about moving forward and projecting uses and spaces that would be necessary moving forward with that projected demographic. And so as a result of that, we've been taking my space needs assessment, the original one, and David's cost estimate, and what we've gone out and seen and said we wanted to incorporate, and kind of really fine-tuning that a bit. We have a little bit more work to do on that, and then we're really going to be looking for feedback from the professionals insofar as what's feasible and what isn't. So we're kind of at a point, besides just continuing to hone what we have, needing more support from the other professional pieces of that picture. So I apologize for not being able to give you more information site-wise and all the rest of that, but we're
Yeah, I mean, I appreciate how much you've done, knowing that you were constrained in that regard. And just a quick update on the RFQ review committee for the OPM.
Yeah.
So we met, and we have it down to three finalists, but recognizing the critical role that this individual or this firm is going to play going forward in the future of all of these buildings, or dealing with these building issues, we want to make sure that it's the right fit, so thought it would be prudent to do in-person interviews.
Mm-hmm.
So those are now scheduled, actually, for those of you who are on the committee in the room, for the 22nd?
Yes.
Okay, so the evening of June 22nd. And then coming from that, the review committee should have a recommendation for the select board at the meeting on the 29th.
Wonderful.
Okay. So that's just give you a sense of timing.
Do you have any direction for us to move forward with anything in particular besides what we have been doing?
Have any more visits cited?
Do we have any more visits cited?
Not specifically, but there are certain senior centers that have been mentioned that we thought we would check out.
Mm-hmm. It sounds like you've honed it down as to what you're looking for a
facility
and a
great degree, to a great degree for what we can do based on what we use. What we've seen, we will and won't use from other centers, and what projected needs are. I mean, I think our vision has shifted, not in the size, but in some of the configurations, which is great.
Okay. So, any questions for Suzanne or Jane?
Thank you for doing all that.
Oh, Mr. Ruskevitz?
Yeah, I have a question. One thing our committee has talked about is a joint venture with another department, and have you considered maybe combining with another department? And are there any examples in Massachusetts that you could visit that would be more like a community center, as not just a senior center?
Mm-hmm. The ones that we have visited for were senior center only. One was a community center, and they did not like the venture for a lot of different reasons, but that was their response to us. How is that working for you? It was a mandate for them to get it built, and I think it suffers, the senior participation suffers a little bit because of it, because they've voiced some uncomfortableness in interacting in the same setting. The seniors get worried about, they feel like they shouldn't be on the equipment if there's other people there. So a sense of loss of ownership of the space, so to speak. And also when other grade school activities happen, they find that the cleanup is, you know, this brand new carpeting that they had put in now has, you know, candy squished into it, and they don't jive, they don't appreciate each other, so it's kind of a strange relationship. It's also a hassle for scheduling, because not unlike what we do at our center, we no longer rent it out for private parties, because that means somebody else has to come on the clock to open and close that building, and then the cleaning has to get done. And it turns out to be a wash between what you actually make in renting it out and what it costs to staff and clean the building.
Okay. Any other questions for Council on Aging? Okay. If not, then I'm sure you guys are staying for the rest of the Building Committee's report as well. Tim is passing out. Dave, are you doing the talking? Or?
Sure, why not?
Okay.
Yeah, if you happen to.
Thanks, Tim.
I made hopefully enough copies for everyone. This is hot off the press, so if you find any typos or anything else, we'll take care of that afterwards. How much time do you want me to spend here, roughly?
Well,
this could go 2 hours, or this could go.
Yeah, I mean, let's try to keep it to half an hour.
Okay.
Yeah.
Maximum.
You mean maximum.
is actual.
Yeah.
Or less.
But, I mean, we don't want to give you short shrift either, so.
No, of course. Okay, so I won't give you the long story about how we've been working for 2 years on building recommendations, and in many ways understood that we first had to do no harm to the buildings. We had to bring them up to a certain level of safety. And so our first, you know, year or so was all about that, about the critical repairs necessary. So those were undertaken and detracted us a little bit from our original charge to make recommendations on the fate of the buildings. But that said, I think we've come to a point where we have some pretty solid decisions in here. Some things we're gonna need some help with in the long term, sort of figuring out, the short term figuring out. But I'm gonna start with something of a criteria for the recommendations that we established, which is on the first page. And we had to think about what was important, recognizing from many of you that we can't do everything all at once. So the priorities are important in what is the priority. So what we call the type A, the first priority, hands down, was to complete municipal buildings projects which support town-required emergency life safety first response services, which include police and fire, potentially even DPW emergency responses, so deemed. But those are the immediate short-term needs of those services. Those have to be paramount, and the committee agreed unanimously that that would be the case. The second, the type B type of improvements are projects which are needed to address immediate accommodations for departments that have been or will be displaced in the near future. You know, we know of one because of the sale of the North Hadley Village Hall and the Park and Rec Department not having the space. So that's an imminent need, which we will talk about coming up. The next one, the type C projects are items which address longer term public safety, health, and welfare of the occupants, essentially addressing unsafe buildings. I want to say, though, we've addressed the unsafe conditions of all the buildings to date, so we're not overlooking anything at this time. We're just prioritizing it in that sense. And lastly, accommodating departmental programs which currently reside in functional space but lack adequate space now or in the near future. So the space needs. Getting to recommendation one, this was one of our strongest recommendations, which was kind of a two-part to deeming the North Hadley Village Hall as a property that should be sold, which was voted on, as you know, at town meeting. And that recommendation is to now locate new accommodations for fire apparatus that are in North Hadley. I'm probably gonna say it again, that we're not fire fighters, we're not librarians, so we lack all of the knowledge to understand the departmental needs. That's why we ask for interviews, we ask for department heads to come in and describe them to us. And we have to take them at their value, that if the fire chief describes the need for apparatus in North Hadley, then that's how we proceed. And so the committee all agreed that finding department apparatus space in North Hadley is the first thing we need to do, knowing that building's gonna get sold and that we're gonna get a new fire truck in October. So the recommendation that we originally came up with, which we call 1A, was to construct new bays at Center Station, but that was preempted by the fire chief's description of the services and how that would actually make response times longer for North Hadley residents. Option 1B, to build a new fire substation on a new site. I should say that all of these recommendations, the time frame is such that we are going to have to find a location for those trucks up in North Hadley. So the committee agrees unanimously that we need to search for some leasable space or some other short-term solution for fire department in North Hadley. So that's with all these recommendations, that's a necessity. So again, 1B is to build a new fire substation on a new site. That was our original committee recommendation based on what we perceived as some certain hindrances to building on the ball field. But We did look at that as well. Mr. Muskowski has formed an ad hoc committee, as we all know, to consider that property, the ball field property, as opposed to finding a new site. We had looked at it probably a year and a half ago and found some constraints relative to parking, sight lines, general safety, not insurmountable, but we thought probably in the long term that property wasn't large enough for what could be the necessity of further expansion someday. So we had passed it over in that sense, but are willing to see what Mr. Miskowski's committee comes up with in terms of solutions. So our recommendation for that ultimately hinges on whether that is successful and we can find some common ground that works with the prospective buyer of that property. And we'll wait and see how that goes. Any comments from my crew?
I think we have to stress the issue is that we're looking at an October deadline that we're faced with the truck coming. So with a long discussion, I mean, what is our short-term solution? It could very well be lease space. There are some viable issues, but we have to make sure that we follow the proper procedures on that. So we do have that as a good option. I think we need to start making some sound discussions back and forth between the groups and figure out how we're going to handle this, if that's the way that we're going to approach it, because right now we don't see an alternative. We need that truck up there in North Hadley because of the response time. So how do we deal with that lease space problem?
And just to give you the timeline, we're trying to develop some timelines on these activities. If you were to say go, and we know we have an OPM that's going to be on board soon, which is an advantage to us, then fall town meeting is an important date, which we need to preserve, and probably need to work with the OPM to determine what the full cost of the project would be, which includes the design fee. So I'm not too familiar with which votes would be necessary, but what I'd be recommending is that we look at approval of funds for the design and the construction of fire substation in the fall. Mm-hmm. And if that is approved, then we could follow on with a designer selection, get a designer on board early next year, complete the design of showing in August of 2017, advertise September 2017, a second town meeting next fall if necessary to finalize any overages in the bids or anything that we didn't foresee in terms of funding, for a contract notice to proceed 2018. The building we think we need is not a heavy lift for a contractor, so by the end of 2018 we would have a new building. All goes perfectly well and we decide to do this today.
So this 2.5 years from now, right. Not from fall town meeting, from now.
That's yeah. Right.
Okay.
That's right. And more or less the same timeline would apply to the second option, which Mr. Miskowski is planning. I think either one would be about the same time frame. The site selection process could take longer. We just don't know at this time until we see what the options are. So recommendation two, falling back to our type B, which is housing services, which are going to be vacated for one reason or another, is to address the park and recreation space, which resides at North Hadley Village Hall. There's been a couple of options that have been on our thoughts here for a while. I thought it was kind of at one point unanimous, but we've been considering again the possibility of the use of the senior center upper floor, the second floor, for a swing space for that that program. Some of our members feel that is a viable option, where we could spend minimal dollars renovating that portion of the senior center to occupy for park and rec use. We're torn on that, to be honest. I'm personally concerned over the condition of the building, and I want to make sure that regardless of what the code requires, that we're not putting any of our children at risk, putting anything in there. So I think it warrants.
You're not worried about the Zumba people?
Well,
but.
Okay, you don't have to answer that.
It's an awkward statement.
Not worried about your mother?
I'm worried about, she's watching.
Oh, I got it.
All right, listen, I made it from kindergarten all the way out the door.
As did I.
I haven't had a problem yet, so.
Yeah, oh.
Come on, Jerry, what's your opinion?
That was wide open.
I opened that one up. I gotta liven this up a little bit.
I understand where you're going with this, okay.
So, but.
We can see where it didn't affect you.
You know, I think as an architect, I recognize the code implications of this, and if we spend a certain amount of dollars on the renovation, it's gonna trigger a lot of things, you know, seismic, electrical, mechanical, roof structural.
As we said with these old buildings, you're opening them Pandora's box.
The benefit is we have a new roof over that area, we have new doors, we extended the longevity of that building by about maybe 10 years before we're gonna have to do something again. Which buys us enough time to do something with the senior center and some other things, but do we wanna throw good money onto something that we're gonna just eventually do something completely different with? That's my own personal concern over this. In the interest of saving funds, maybe this is a good solution. However, I will say that, you know, initial real estate searches from Park and Rec have shown that leasable space may be equal to roughly the utility costs at North Hadley Village Hall. So I'm not sure that we would be paying a heck of a lot more money to go into the leasable space, whereas we might have to use town funds or borrow to make that renovation happen. Mm-hmm. So all concerns that that we haven't come to a conclusion on yet. Mm-hmm. Doing okay?
Yep.
Questions, anything?
I'll keep going.
Okay. So recommendation number three is the senior center. We've always recognized the poor condition of the senior center, as I started to allude to, and the program spaces and needs for improvement. We have a couple of different scenarios that the group's established for this this recommendation. And the first is kind of simple, to construct a new community center, and whether that would be on the back parcel, which was the initial thought, or this land RFP would enable us to have some more property that's either contiguous or somewhere else in town center that we could build something. Those are all really good options. We would prefer not to take off the table the idea of a community center that could encompass both seniors and Park and Rec. Hearing Suzanne's concerns, I think that it warrants further consideration before we make a final decision. Initially, we thought it was a good idea because we reduced the duplicity of mechanical services. We might be able to take advantage of some spaces that would be in both buildings someday, so it seems to make sense, but recognize there's some functional, you know, concerns with that. So a new senior center building that has a similar timeline, recognizing probably aren't going to want to do everything at once, but if we got the OPM started on that and looked at also funding identification, whether there's some additional funding out there somewhere, or if we'd have to borrow the entire amount. It more or less puts us around the end of December 2019, at which point we would have that building vacated. And I say that only for the sense that the library has plans that may or may not be hinging on whether that senior center is vacated. The reason it is a little bit longer is probably because the construction is a little more sensitive. Lots of less, you know, seeing big walls and things like that, more intricate finishes and details. So, and the design might take a little bit longer as well. Mm-hmm. So that's the thought. Now, that's option A for recommendation three. Option B was proposed by several committee members as well, recognizing that the public safety complex has not really ultimately been a perfect fit for police and fire. We know that there's shortcomings there. We think some of them could be addressed in the longer term, but it may be a smart move to take a look at replacing that building with something that functionally addresses their needs. So In this scenario, we would build a new public safety complex on probably a new site in the center of town, and then would go back and renovate the existing public safety complex for a combination senior center, park and rec building. Thoughts were maybe to take the apparatus bays and make that into a larger assembly room to build some kind of bump out on one side and use the existing site for one of the services so that they meet in the middle with the assembly space. We're mixed on this, honestly. There's a divide in the committee about how we feel about this. It does prolong the replacement of services for the seniors because we would have to build a fire apparatus for public safety complex first, and then not only do that, but renovate that space before seniors would have a new building. So just adding up everything, I think we're talking probably 5 to 6 years before that entire program is in place. We'd probably be able to get the design completed while the fire station was underway or something. So there's some overlap there, probably 5 years. We didn't finalize this recommendation only because the committee feels like we don't really have enough cost information to compare how all this would play out. Renovation sounds like a good idea. It can get expensive, and sometimes it's easier to build new, but we'd like to recommend that there's additional design undertaken by either the project consultant, the OPM, or some other professional that could analyze the cost for us a little bit more. Questions?
Anything to add, guys?
We're still with it.
Keep going.
You know, I just put something to say. I mean, throughout the whole committee's view of everything, originally when you were put together, we all decided, the board decided, along with the committee that we instituted, was we're looking 50 or 60 years down the road at these buildings. You know, the police and fire have already overgrown their building. They really have. I mean, and everybody's aware of that. The senior center, I myself am going to be using it pretty soon, you know. Eventually down the road here, you know. Same thing with the library. The library just doesn't have room for the rest of their books that they have right now, you know. So, you know, instead of looking 15 or 20 years down the road, we really need to keep that in the back of our minds. You know, it's just like our infrastructure, 60 years old right now, you know, that we need to address. It's everything's to that point right now.
Thank you. On to recommendation 4, which really only pairs with 3A. So if we were to simply build a new senior center or community center, we would afterwards go back and make repairs to the public safety complex. Now, this has been difficult for us to get our arms around because we lack the direction from you, the select board, on whether we would have full-time firemen, whether we would have an ambulance service. Mm-hmm. All those functions have to be housed somewhere. So initially, our thoughts were that the area north of the station where the ball field parking is and that vicinity on that side, we could build out some additional program space on that side of the apparatus base, and then maybe house fire there and keep police on the existing side or vice versa, so that they each get a little more space out of that, and then we'd have to talk about additional capacity of the bays as well, so that'd be a concern. But we think there's some ways to do it. We just don't know what the program is, so we haven't advanced that any further.
Mm-hmm. Actually, David, one of the reasons we had sort of favored a new building in some ways is because it gives us more options. We could design a building for the future that would be designed, not necessarily totally built, but designed with expansion capability. And currently, we don't have that situation at the public safety building, we don't feel, but perhaps a designer could come up with a way that we could do that. But that was part of the reason we would consider going in that direction, and that gives us more options for the future. So,
and that's really where the OPM is playing a critical role going forward.
So we're emphasizing, I think that's where we are at. We really think that we need to get some money together to say, this is what we need. We got to get some idea of both concepts and see which one is the most viable. Because we've been hashing this around quite a bit, and like David said, could very well be that a new building would be far cheaper, even with renovating that for the community center. So it really would help us all to come up with some funding, to get some preliminary designs on all these, and with some fundamental costs, and then we can have a better understanding of which way we can go. And it'll give the people more than one option.
And full-time fire force and ambulance is also critical.
Right.
Yeah.
But I think David's point, David Skovitz's point is critical, that the one nice thing about doing a new building is that we can phase that in over time as the departments grow. And that's probably an easy way of handling what the town could project as services for both departments.
And to go into John's point, we have been thinking about 50 years out. That's what we're trying to do here. Mm-hmm. So,
I think a comparison, what they're saying is, when the elementary school was built, it's ideal situation. It's all set for 8 additional classrooms, a wing to be added to it. It'd be a cost, but again, it wouldn't be anywhere near a new building, and they could accommodate another 200 students.
And that was the thought at the time.
That was the thought at the time, that additional wing is there. If it's ever needed, it could be built.
I was on that.
Do you want to keep going?
Yeah, let's go. Okay, so recommendation number 5 addresses Department of Public Works. Recognizing we've had Marlo only for a short few months, we've given him some time to look at his needs and haven't had him yet interview with us to talk directly about his concerns relative to the public's the DPW. There is some concerns that we've historically heard about the water department or the sewer department existing on site, and future expansion of that service might really prohibit additional expansion of the public works garages and capacity in that area. So I think it's probably time Marlo's gotten enough information, is ready to come see us and talk to us about that. Our biggest concern with the DPW had been the field trailers, which were serving as office space for much, much longer than they should have. And potentially looking at the addition of a wash bay that would essentially prolong the fleet vehicle's life, get the road salted and sand off them promptly. So those are some thoughts. We have not yet heard from Mr. Warner, so there's a recommendation there, but it's really a placeholder for now. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Another comment. I spoke with Mr. Warren this morning, and he's working on what you're requesting right now. He's coming up with a presentation arranging his staff and building recommendations, but he's tied up with Route 9 so much right now, it's sort of put on the back burner a little bit, but he is working on it.
Go ahead, Jim.
Okay, so recommendation 6 is the library expansion, and I feel I need to preface this by saying that the trustees have done such a wonderful job with the Goodwin that it hadn't been on our radar initially because of the building condition, that they've done such a nice job of upkeep that we weren't concerned over replacement of the building. That said, and we're not librarians, but they've made a strong case that there's expansion needs, program expansion needs, space needs for the library. And that is not one of our first priorities, as I described in the first page. So it's lower on our list, but that said, the library's done a wonderful job of collaborating with us to find space in town. I think we all as a committee hope that the good one could be preserved and maybe expanded, but that played out to not be the case because of some concerns over the siding and the utilities behind the library building. So it doesn't look feasible. We're still concerned about reuse of that building and what we could do with it. There's one scenario by which the Department of Agriculture may have some use for it as a kind of visitor center for the Pioneer Valley, but that's very premature to really speculate if that would work for them or not. And we don't see another building or another department, Hadley Department, fitting properly into that site. It's the same concerns that the library has with accessibility, restrooms, all of those things. So that's essentially where we are with the library recommendation recommend they continue with looking for funds, but understand that there's priorities above them. Mm-hmm.
So I'm just wondering, for documentation purposes, if this should say that the library is not handicap accessible. So nowhere in here does it explain that the library is not handicap accessible. I just wonder if that should be a consideration.
But you are accessible to get into there. You built a ramp and things.
You can get into the door.
Right.
You cannot get around in the first floor. You cannot use the bathroom. So it is not handicap accessible.
Totally handicap accessible. It's accessible, but not totally.
David, do you have an objection to just making a note of that?
No,
I'm not trying
to
argue that. I'm just
trying
to explain we're not handicapped.
It's a good point. I would argue it doesn't really necessarily advance your project over others.
No, I'm just saying for documentation purposes.
It is definitely something that should be documented, so we'll do that.
Okay.
I've got a question, too. Say if the townspeople voted on a site and they agreed to go ahead with the library, how long of a period would you have before it would have to be shovel ready?
I'm not really understanding that.
What I'm asking is, say if it's passed,
right,
and then you're granted funds,
right,
do you have to do it immediately, or is there a waiting period where you could wait 2-3 years before you draw the funds?
So this is what happens. So we would apply for the grant in January if the town said they wanted us to. We would apply for the grant, and then in next June, we would find out if we got the grant.
Mm-hmm.
Then the following fall of 2017, the town still would have to vote on whether they accepted the grant and accepted the financial costs. Mm-hmm. So that's 2017. Then we'd be given a number in the lineup of libraries in Western Mass that have been given the grant. We do not know what that number is. When we would get that number, say we were the third, when our number came up, we would have to be ready to bill. So it's kind of an unsure, I'm sorry I can't give you like a definitive time, but that's kind of how the system works.
2019 would be the earliest that construction could begin. And it's unlikely that we would be in the first round of buildings, so we've been told, because there are other
right,
cases of greater need in other communities, but we would be closer to the front rather than to the back based on the accessibility issues.
Did ask this question of the MBLC.
Yeah, with the timetable that you're creating, David, it almost seems like it could work into the priority list.
It could work. We did this exercise last fall as well and thought the same thing. Unfortunately, we weren't really able to communicate that well with town meeting, but if you chose to advance the senior center, that space would be vacated and would be an option should you all choose to demolish Hooker School. And I know that's a big if, because that is a property that's considered, you know, of significance to this town. So as the library is looking for other parcels, that's also a solution. But you're right, it would be, it would work. We might have one project complete and then be able to start the next. Recommendation 7, Town Hall Departments and Russell School. We haven't advanced this too far because we think this is the biggest, heaviest lift for the town in terms of funding. The town departments that are here in the town hall do lack space. There's some concerns with that, and some of our original surveys vetted that out. But it's not to a critical mass yet that we're recommend advancing any of the work here, except for what we've done already to mitigate the asbestos. But we do think, at least in terms of square footage, that there's a nice fit in the Russell School property, which would provide additional expansion for town services. The idea of even maybe bringing other boards and departments into the town building as well is a possibility. There is concern with parking, as we know. Whether that is a solution that works out with the library's plans, if they were to go to that site, maybe that's the case. It also poses the concern that this building would somehow be vacated at some point. And then what do we do with another empty town building, right? And it would be a beautiful building to have town meeting in if we had a huge parking lot next to it, and we don't. And you know, short of taking this and moving it over to West Street Common, I don't think there's any other solutions here. So at this time, we're kind of recommending that town services remain in town hall for now, and that the Russell School is carefully monitored and preserved for the longer term. We think it's an important enough building to keep within the town ownership, but that's going to mean regular upkeep. That's going to mean the roof repairs that we do almost annually to replace tiles, and it's going to be monitoring the brick and some other things. There are currently no historic preservation restrictions on Russell School, and that's something that we'd recommend that the Historic Commission look at, particularly if we all chose to release that for sale at some point. The committee is not recommending that at this point, but that's something that you probably should have regardless on there. And I think it's also important that the Historical Committee look at additional funds that may be available through CPA. There's been a kind of change in tide at CPA as to what can be covered or not covered. We think that building, we personally think any of the work on that building is preservation work, and as such should be eligible for preservation funds. But there's a fine line between maintenance and preservation. And
but you've worked on enough old buildings to certainly know that once you start opening up that building over there, it's
no
not
question.
Handicap accessible, electricity, the boilers, the asbestos.
Right.
You know, you have all of that going on, and prevailing wage is going to kill us.
Yeah.
You know,
we all know that.
You know, we've already talked about this old building. Here we go again. You know, it's a nice building, yes. Bathrooms, none. We're looking at the same thing that the library is looking at.
It's a full gut.
It's a full gut. You know, elevator, the whole nine yards, and whether or not, because I know when we were looking at building the elementary school, we did the, Marco Jones did the architectural look at that building, and we had weights over there. We did, it was sinking to the ground in the back. You know, we did, all of that has to be taken into consideration. That's
right.
Tremendous amount of work on that building.
And it'd be extremely expensive, but it's something that, it is one of the nicest buildings. It's an icon, but it is something that we have to present to the people of the town. Yes, it's going to be a huge amount of money to just restore it to what it is before we even think about if it could be used for municipal. But
People's money. Here we go. That's going to be
talking tens of millions.
It is an icon building, and it could remain an icon, but it's a lot easier to deal with it in the private sector than a municipal sector.
That is something
if
we
it
have
became
to
a medical facility building, they could make money on it and remodel it, and it would still make the center of town the same impression when you drive through a beautiful area.
Exactly.
They would
just
retain
like
the historical aspect.
Right.
But it's a building that we can't afford to keep anymore, in my estimation.
But that's the last recommendation. Mm-hmm. Yeah, had bigger,
one,
yeah. Bigger
one
fish
more.
To fry.
One more.
Oh, one more.
Yeah, we have one more. and then you guys want to jump on this one, or can I just that's fine. So in parallel with all these recommendations, we from the get-go have strongly recommended that there's a maintenance program that be assembled to not get into the same kind of trouble that we're in today with, you know, underfunding projects and maintenance. So we think that someone should study more closely what a program would mean and what kind of monitoring that would be. At one point, we recommended that there be a person who approves any kind of maintenance spending, you know, with some simple forms, things like that. Other towns have done this kind of thing. And that maintenance budgets ought to be in the same place as opposed to spread through different departments. That's been a concern. Capital improvements to buildings, you know, as we start building things, we're gonna know what the lifespan is of equipment and things and how long until they're gonna need replacement. So we should start to look at improvements way farther out than just trying to tackle something for next year. We know elevators have a certain lifespan or any kind of mechanical equipment, 15 years, whatever. So we should plan to have that in our budget. And so I think that there should be some assembly of a program that addresses that and then is probably monitored every year by a committee or some other group that looks at what we thought the long-term plan was, what it actually is, has it changed, all that business. So I think that's really important to us, and we think that should be implemented as soon as possible.
No, I think a perfect example is when we lacked maintaining the town hall and North Hadley Hall, and then we went out to bid for the painting of both of them, and a 10-cent call cost us $68,000 more, and EPA started writing all new regulations how we were going to do the job. They didn't even have the regulations, but we had to hear what they wanted. And if you don't maintain your buildings, that's what you're confronted with.
Questions or comments for the Municipal Building Committee?
No, I think they've done a great job, and thank you very much for your hard work these last couple of years. It's been a trial and tribulation for you, I'm sure, but we appreciate everything you've done.
Happy to help.
Thank you.
John or Jerry? Anything for them?
Yeah, good job. Good work, guys.
Yeah, I was just saying.
And it's been 2 years, and we still haven't made any progress, but don't lose faith.
A tremendous amount of projects have been done. Tremendous.
As far as new buildings.
Yeah, and I was just going to say, I mean, I think, you know, it's been a long haul, but in my mind, this was exactly the outcome, you know, the output from the committee that I was certainly hoping for a long time ago. We have to acknowledge the constraints that have been put on you and the decisions that need to be made in order for you to get any further with this process. So, you know, I know we said this it was last week or the week, but the meetings are starting to blend into one another, but I know that we did publicly talk about the fact that we have to make a decision sooner rather than later, specifically about the fire apparatus. So finding some sort of housing. That was last week?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
so that's loud and clear, and then also the maintenance. I mean, there's no reason why we can't be moving on that sooner rather than later. And then hope the OPM should be arriving soon. So did you want to talk a little bit about the mission, you know, your thoughts? I mean, I know I've talked to some of you individually about basically where do we go from here with the Municipal Building Committee. Do you have thoughts on that you want to share?
I think at this point it's at the selectmen's wishes. You know, do you want us to continue what we're doing, and what role do you think we would play in all this?
I mean, if you want our input, I mean, I've given that to you in an email. I think there's two tasks that the municipal building could be tasked with. One is what David said with regard to maintenance. Be the overseer, bring forward a yearly budget to you, prioritize projects for maintenance of all the buildings, and be that liaison between maintenance personnel, director, whatever you want to call him, and your board. And they'll take a lot of the daily, weekly stuff off you and just come with some recommendations of what needs to be done and why, prioritizing everything.
So presumably that's in concert with the DPW, right?
Exactly.
Right now maintenance comes through DPW.
Every way that wants to be set up. And the other one would be overseeing all these subcommittees that's going to probably be formed with the new buildings and any renovation, large renovations, and directing, you know, being working with the OPM with regard to how it all can fit together.
But really directing the activities.
That's funny, yeah.
And directing the activities of the OPM.
Correct.
Because it seems to me we're going to have the OPM is going to be tasked with multiple efforts.
And, right. And they're 2 years in depth into this thing now, with great direction as far as I'm concerned. And I don't see why they can't continue to bring that information to us, you know. It's absolutely over all of our heads right now.
Yeah, I think they're moving in a positive direction, and I wouldn't want it to stop.
Once we have the OPM on board, would it be advisable to use that person for the study for the substation in North Hadley? Seeing that's our first priority project?
I haven't seen the qualifications of the OPMs, but generally there's a design services component that's within that, which would enable them to have enough skills to do that for us, to come up with some programming documents and some cost estimating. They wouldn't provide the design services, the full design package, but the initial concept planning and development easily.
I know this is going to be a difficult thing to bring up, but we talked about it 2 weeks ago about reconstructing the committee. And I'm a firm believer we have to take our two inspectors off of that committee, and they have to become advisory members. They can't award contracts and then go out and inspect those contracts. You know, they're serving two masters. They have to serve the town only. I know they have valuable information provided to this committee, but they can provide the same information as advisory and not voting. And then they're going to retain their neutrality when they go to town meeting. They can speak in behalf of the town of Hadley as our inspectors. You know, I don't know how the rest of the board feels about it, but that's just my opinion, and we talked about it a little bit. And I would like to hear some other discussion from other board members.
Yeah, but Lynn, let me just jump in, because I'm the one that raised it in the first place. So I just want to be crystal clear on my opinion on that. I brought it up from the standpoint that when we first formed the committee, there was some discussion and a little bit of consternation about having any of our own employees on the committee in the first place. Again, we're talking 2 years ago now. And had always, in my mind, had always had the thought that once we kind of brought phase one, this presentation, to a conclusion, that we would then look at the formation of the committee in the context of what the next tasks were. So the reason I brought it up again last week was to say, okay, are we at a point now where we need to look at whether or not the inspectors in particular, I'm less concerned about Gary Berg's role, but the inspectors in particular, should they become advisory in nature, because we're moving into a phase where we're going to be doing hiring and actually starting to get into these, you know, design issues and the like. It bowled me over with a feather. Sometimes I'm actually not right. I can acknowledge that publicly. It does happen. Don't mention that to my kids. But in further conversation with members of the committee, what they've impressed upon me, I didn't talk to everybody, but almost all of you, is that we're really not at that point yet, that's a ways away yet. You know, from my standpoint, I continue to think that had we started this way, it would have been more prudent to have had the inspectors be advisory in nature. Because of another fact that you're all part of the town team. You know, you have coworkers, and part of what's always rattled around in my head is if we get into situations where you have town departments kind of jockeying for position and vying for their particular project, never would I want another municipal co-worker put in a difficult position of feeling like they were making decisions between departments, okay? So that was, you know, that was also part of the thought process around having it be advisory versus voting. At this juncture, I'm less concerned about that now, to the extent the team feels that they're working well together. You know, you're relying on each other for that input. I'm still questioning whether or not you want other people on the committee with you to help, and that's, you know, would leave that open to you. At some point, however, to Donald's point, I think there needs to be a clear line of demarcation, and I think Tim and Willie are probably well aware of when that will happen, that you'd have to take a step back. And again, Tim, I think you've articulated kind of when that might be. So,
and then that is very simple. If a time comes where there's good, a decision has to be made because of, for an inspection, we have alternate inspectors just for that reason, to take, if we're sitting on a committee and they got to bring a set of electrical specs and I approve them, all that, and it goes to the building, then the alternate electrical inspector comes over and he inspects the building because I designed the electrical system and I can't do it. So that's something that we have, and that's why we have an alternate, not only for that reason, but in case we're sick or we can't, we're not around.
It's similar to the conflicts I have with the wastewater and the DPW and sitting on the board here. You know, I mean, you gotta know where one job ends and your next job begins.
That's correct.
And if you're not aware of that, then I can see, you know, getting rid of that person on the committee. But after 2 years, there's really been no conflicts with that board at all, and they've done a great job.
And we have been working very, very well together. So
it's actually the opposite of not having conflicts. I think the institutional knowledge that gets brought to the meetings, and I see as the liaison the amount of knowledge that they have and the importance of that knowledge, rather than run out and try to find that out ourselves, is immensely important to what gets done over there. I think, as John had said, that when it comes to being a non-voting thing, you non-vote. And we rely on you and the rest of the department and the rest of the committee to make sure that gets done. But I think, like I said, the institutional knowledge and about the buildings that we have here in the town of Hadley is immensely important from both of those fellows being up here.
Dave, you want to say something?
Yeah, the one thing to keep in mind, too, is there should not be a conflict with the contractors because this is a bid process. These guys don't pick the contractors.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They might have some influence or involvement with picking the architect, perhaps, but mm-hmm. they can always defer. They don't have to be on the subcommittees. So there's ways around it. There's seven members here, so I think mm-hmm. we can work around that.
And we started the process with the first design professional. That was one thing that we certainly said right from the day, right as soon as we started talking about it. We're not part of that. We can't be, we should not be. I think there, and I told, this was in my email. I've been around the block, this is my 29th year here. I know when I need to bow out. And there will be a time that I'm gonna bow out of this committee. And I told you in my email, I'm bowing out now. If you guys want, it's nice to hear what you've just said to me, because that means a lot. I don't like how this started, and I'm liking more how it's ending. But I think, if I may speak, it's. When you're talking about people that are ready and willing to volunteer their time, and every member here has put hundreds of hours in on this stuff, I think there is a time when things should be said in public and things that should not be said in public to, if there's issues like this. This, I don't think it was handled as well as it could have been. We were, both Willie and I were kind of blindsided on this. Would have been nice if we were spoken to beforehand. But when it comes to, and I think David was the best when he said this, don't ever fault a volunteer, ever. Because they're coming forward and spending their time and effort without pay
to help the town. They don't do wrong. You might disagree with something they're discussing, but they don't do wrong because they're volunteering. And I think that's been a real problem as of late. I think that's one of the reasons why we don't have enough volunteers in this town, because it has been on many of these boards, people coming in public meetings and being too critical of the volunteers that we have. And David was good to finally stand up and say something. Don't start saying bad about volunteers. You might not disagree, you might not agree with what they're doing, but come on, we're not employees on this stuff. But I do thank Jerry, thank you for saying what you did. I mean,
we're all on all these boards and committees doing the best for our community and for our town that we've lived in our whole lives.
But lately, there's been too many things said, and it's very, and that's one of the reasons I gave Molly the email I did. I said, I don't want to be part of any committee when I have to come in and sit down and have somebody come in and say that I said something based on wrong facts years ago. And we have to stop doing that in this town. And it's been going on way too much. And it's just not right.
Well, there's a reason we have a code of conduct that we're trying to adopt. And again, we strongly encourage that to be adopted across all town boards.
And it should be all town boards, because it's been a problem lately.
There's a bigger picture here too, Tim. You're not embarking on. We as a board of selectmen, we're compelled by the Ethics Commission to show transparency. And if we don't show transparency, that means we're trying to hide something. And we don't want to do that. We want to be as transparent as we can be with the general public. As I said in the beginning, this was going to be a very tough discussion. But we have to be transparent with the general public or we lose everything.
Yeah, but we don't have to disparage. Gary?
I mean, my knowledge right now, we're basically an advisory committee to the select board.
Yep.
In town. So we're not in charge of handing out any contracts or anything like that. I mean, mm-hmm. like Tim says, if something comes up that, you know, if there's a conflict, they get an alternate. Mm-hmm. If the board changes to a different position where we're actually hiring somebody and awarding contracts, not making a recommendation,
then we're out.
Yep.
And that's not going to happen.
There has never been any doubt that there's been any illegal or anything going on from this board with this committee at all. We have never projected that something illegal has been going on or whatever. It's always been transparent with the public of anything that you've been doing. All of your meetings have been publicized. They've been televised. How more upfront can you be with everybody? So, you know, all of that needs to be taken into consideration, too. You've never, any one of you, ever done anything to benefit your position or any board that you are on whatsoever. So, kudos to you, and just, we're happy with the job you're doing. So that's as far as I'm concerned.
I agree with Joyce 100%, but my intention was trying to protect you two people from getting into an awkward situation. That was my only intent.
I don't even know where you came from with that, but I'm not going to get into that with you tonight. But
it was saying, our chairman brought it up. Not me. That's where it got started.
Again,
so you reverse it.
Again, I brought it up. I think I was very clear on the context of bringing it up.
But I don't know why you went to their meeting and did that last night without going through the chairman. If she had a problem with it, it should be up to the chairman to go to that board and say something to them, not you. You weren't their liaison. Jerry is. So
it's a public meeting. I can say what I want as an individual. I wasn't saying it
also,
as a selectman.
But you are also,
I was saying as an individual.
You are also representing us as a selectman when you go to these meetings.
Okay, so
not if I say I'm not representing the board.
I'm
I can
sorry.
Go to any meeting in town just like you can.
I think we'll take it up when we talk about the code of conduct. So just sticking with, we have a lot of volunteers this late, and they've spent a lot of time. So I mean, one question is just coming out of it. So they're recommending two primary missions for the Municipal Building Committee going forward. One of them, again, you know, utilizing the services of the OPM, making recommendations, again, your advisory, back to us. about how to prioritize and utilize those services in the context of these recommendations. You're also reliant on us getting information back to you in a couple of places that you've very nicely outlined. It should be crystal clear. And then moving forward with the maintenance. Yeti?
Yeah, the only other thing that I think that our committee could do for the select board is to follow through on the recommendations that you suggest we follow through on.
So exactly, yeah.
We can take charge, take the reins, and move these projects forward for you as soon as we know what they are.
But the direction needs to be provided from this
group. From you.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, you got that. Joanne?
Mine is more general when you're done with the committee. Okay. I'll wait till it's about all three.
Okay, John?
Getting back to your agreement with the green bond proposal and the place for the fire trucks, I would think it would be possible that you extend that for a year with him so you could house the trucks. They extend that doorway out, house the trucks there in that station, and he does that in two phases. The big part phases it in there, and I think you could make it work with him, and I think he would work with the town to do that, and that would save you looking for a place for those engines with a modest cost of just moving those doors out.
You would have to check with historical preservation if they put on that about changing. It would have to be all.
Well, that's just going to be a temporary deal.
Joanne, one thing, and then we'll move on. Yeah.
Well, mine was just a general question about kind of moving forward with us and with the senior center and the building committee, kind of what the select board envisions as we move forward through the summer and prepare for fall town meeting. Did you expect us to come in and report where we are? Like, what would be the best way to keep the communication open? Mm-hmm.
Keep on doing what you're doing.
Yeah.
Via the liaison.
How you are?
Via the liaison.
Right.
Yeah.
It's
with Molly as your.
Yeah, and I'm sitting on the.
Okay.
Yep. So again, I would imagine periodic updates here.
Okay.
So closing this out, thank you for the recommendations. Yes, it's now squarely here to get back to you, but then I think that kind of segues into the who are you piece of the conversation, which is the committee appointments. So we had deferred on the reappointment or appointment of the Municipal Building Committee, along with a couple of other ones for discussion tonight, from last week, pending this conversation. So, at this point, what I think I'm hearing is that you're willing to stay the course. Again, opening it up to the extent you feel like you need additional resources. I saw a couple of shaking heads back there, but some going this way and some going this way. So just talk amongst yourselves. And I know
would advocate
that,
for more resources.
Yeah. Okay. As I guess
co-chair.
If we could get if you'd be willing to come up with a resume effectively for those resources. I mean, are you just looking for a warm body, or are you looking for somebody with architectural experience? That kind of thing.
Understood.
And then I know some committee members aren't clear on what their next steps are, but do we need to be clear on whether, I think what I heard tonight is that we're comfortable, again, at this point, staying the course of the committee is structured with everybody being a voting member, and then we'll address, cross that bridge when we come to it.
So I'm going to make a motion to move this along in the spirit of things tonight to appoint still the committee members that are in place if they'll accept the job.
Well, that's
second.
Okay. So all in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay. You're comfortable with that too? Okay. So you think about it and David?
I've got a bigger question that pertains to this too, and in reference to liaisons. If people don't attend the meetings and their liaisons, like last night, Mr. Devine didn't attend, I attended, I got the information. Our liaisons aren't bringing this information back to the board in a timely fashion where I have to render a vote.
Don't yell in my ear.
Sorry, but I have to render a vote on many subject matters. And we don't get this information back. from them.
So
maybe we have to look at this again, how the process works.
Yeah, actually, I think that fits in when we're talking about the code of conduct. It will kind of resurrect kind of the roles and responsibilities again,
okay.
So that'd be a good
you.
Place to talk about it. Did you want to say something?
I understand that the Municipal Building Committee is not happy with the architect for non-performance issues. If you could send me an email of the specifics of what they're doing or not doing, then I can help you by sending the appropriate letter that puts them on notice that we're going to terminate the contract if they don't wise up.
Sure, David. We did receive that request from you this week, and we're kind of amongst some turmoil about some of our members and trying to get these recommendations to you all promptly tonight. So we didn't get to that yet, but
yeah.
It's on our plate. We'll get
okay.
a response to you soon.
All right, thank you.
And as a final comment, apologies for any offense, any communication styles that we collectively need to work on. Okay, again, I think this is a town-wide issue, and we'll all be the better for it if we can come up with an appropriate way to communicate our ideas to folks without causing agita. Okay? All right, so we all set with municipal building? Okay.
Thanks for your support.
Yeah, thank you guys. And then we had a couple of other committee appointments. We had the Shade Tree Committee and then the HPAD Advisory Committee.
I'll make a motion to reappoint the Shade Committee. We have.
I don't think we have anybody on Shade Tree.
Nobody in place? You want to advertise for it?
I was going to say, can we advertise for it?
Yes.
Okay.
How about the TV5 advisory?
Okay, and then as far as the again, this was something that was brought up last week. I think as far as the HPAD advisory committee goes, we just held off on voting on this last week to see whether or not it makes sense. We haven't had any conversation with the HPAD advisory committee formally, and questioning whether or not we should talk about their charter, whether or not they should take any sort of change in authority. They're advisory at the moment. So it was a question, because now's the time if we're going to discuss stuff that we should. And I don't know how much time we have tonight to engage in.
Who's left on the committee?
Yeah. So Kathy, you're on there, right?
I'm on the committee, yes.
Kathy and David.
And Elsie was
Elsie is still on.
Yes, she just can't be here tonight. Short notice. She's
Pat and Sean
very
and
busy. No, I don't know.
Oh.
So I guess
we need to advertise those also.
So the question is, would you be open to having a discussion about a possible, well, we can talk about the pros and cons. There's no preconceived notion here, just whether or not.
Yes.
Can we schedule that for a future meeting?
Oh.
I'm just, it's.
Oh,
I'm sorry, I can't hear.
I'm here 2 hours.
Yeah, I was just wondering whether,
yeah,
given
works.
The hour, if we need to defer that conversation to a future meeting.
Well, let's have a conversation about what the conversation is going to be.
Yeah.
Mm. Okay.
David, you had some conversation with David. Do you want to?
Okay, so we have a new situation with TV5, Hadley Public Access Television. We have more employees. We're trying to do more with the resources that we have. We're under the mandate from the Department of Revenue to set up the Enterprise Fund, which we're in the process of making that change. So the finances are going to be handled differently, and everybody acknowledges that I've got a lot of my on my plate. It would be a help, I think, to everybody if the advisory committee, the cable television advisory committee, could become the cable television committee, not have an advisory role, but have more of a hands-on approach to the programming. Not the day-to-day operations, but certainly the programming and the kinds of things that we need to start thinking about in the future. With all these buildings that we're talking about, you go to other town halls, you go to other municipal buildings, and they're all wired for cable. You have the remote access TV cameras. You have programming, which is addressing the needs of the millennials. All of this is possible with the resources that we have. The only thing that we don't have is my time to help make it happen, and I think if we end up a committee that is devoted to this can work hand in hand with the station manager, can affect these changes, as well as manage the financial realities that the enterprise fund requires of us.
Similar to the municipal building committee to the board right now,
right.
Pretty much.
Yeah, except focused on the program. Yeah. We can't ever, we don't
well,
ever have time to get into
they're focusing on the buildings.
This.
These people yeah. would just be focusing on our two TV channels right now and the direction we're going.
Right, but they would work hand in hand
yeah.
with Richard for the day-to-day
yeah.
operations, and then. But I mean, still, Richard's still obviously an employee, and you know, from a you know reporting standpoint.
What process do you utilize presently to solve your situations?
We have
Does
monthly meetings.
Does Richard recommend to you, and then you take a vote and either?
We really don't. We're not part of a problem-solving process. Richard has to work with David directly in the select board. So we're advisory. Richard reminds us of that every meeting. We have some good discussions, some good meetings, certainly. But we don't, as a committee, feel like we don't really matter. We have no influence. We don't work with you on any kind of regular basis. We have no interest in, Richard does some things very well. He's a good production guy. Yet at budget time and other times, there's friction and struggle and angry emails going around. So perhaps he could use some help on the middle management kind of level. So we don't think are looking for any power or authority. We're just looking to be taken seriously by Richard and his people and have some meaningful voice to David and you guys. So David suggested, of course, the select board on top, David next, then our committee, and then Richard, and so on and so forth. So David compared it to library trustees and our director at the library. So we really do not get involved with the day-to-day operations of the library, but we have as a library trustee, we have, I think, a really positive working relationship with the director, and there's virtually no friction, and when he needs help, he turns to us, and if we feel strongly about something, he follows that direction. Richard's really independent, as David Nixon said, he's had no supervision, you know, he hasn't wanted it. So I don't know how to say it. I'm not being really articulate. I'm going on too long as usual. But I think there's an opportunity here to build the TV stations by giving Richard more help, whether he wants it or not, whether it's on budget time or developing new programming. TV5 looks pretty much like it did 20 years ago.
But
Richard does a great job editing it with the production. I don't see that changing at all.
Right.
So
but we don't. Again, want to be careful not to personalize this. We're just talking about what's the best structure. And
right.
I think the recommendation is this would be a better structure
right.
for the town.
Right. And this
yeah.
did not come from us. This
effort.
Came from David, I think, looking for some help and some more support mm-hmm. for Richard.
And I think if you look at other towns, there are board of, sorry.
Yeah.
If you look at other towns, there's board of directors and their duties and responsibilities, much like trustees and or commissioners in terms of park and recreation, there's duties and responsibilities of those folks. And both commissioners and the trustees are elected, understood, maybe that's in the far future. But for right now, I feel like it's, you know, there's a lot of, could be a lot of chefs in the pot. And maybe if we minimalize it and there's a committee, whoever's on that, director's committee or whatnot, and the bylaws and such that we can work on and actually have work for the effort toward that station with Richard in mind, with whomever it is. I'm not going to say Richard or myself on the committee, but in terms of the general, whoever the production manager is needs to follow bylines or bylaws. And I think a committee that has a little more oomph under their belt would be able to support that production manager. In a more effective way than we can now.
So would you want to propose, I mean, how would you imagine this going? Would the committee propose like a charter change effectively to us that we would approve, or how?
One thought was to look at how other stations are doing it mm-hmm. and see if we can find a model that works,
okay. and then
or a couple of models, and then write it up and bring it to you. So we're in no rush to do anything here. I mean, the job's getting done, but, you know.
Again, over the past 4 years, Richard, we've brought options in front of you. You know, the school wanted to get involved with a little bit more production of the classrooms and the grades and maybe interested parties learning about what you do and how you do it, and there may be someone within that will be looking for a job. We've been asking you for 4 years now that I've been here, where's your assistant? We get one for 2 or 3 weeks, months, that's it, they're gone. Some are interns, some are not.
There.
We don't know what
part-time,
the problem is.
Part-time, 10 to 15 hours, this kind of work, nobody's going to hang around for long. It's just
but if you had a couple people that you were training throughout.
So, John, are you advocating for the committee to play a greater role?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah. Absolutely.
I know one thing, it's been advertised for months looking for additional members, and you're not getting any response. So I don't know how big the committee actually is. How many people is it designed for total?
It was five.
And we have three now.
And we've had people leave because they feel like
there really isn't a role.
Right.
And
right.
I mean, quite frankly, there isn't a role.
So if
so
you're,
I think we might get some good people back. Sorry, Mommy.
No, if you're willing, if we could, you know, we'll get you on a subsequent select board agenda when you're ready. If you could make a suggestion, and then we can talk in detail that. And
right.
Again, I think the bottom line is if there's a little more to oomph. I'm not going to use the word power. It's not a good one. But if we had a little more substantiality, we could be writing bylaws. And with that bylaw, as every town has, there are bylaws in the station. And it's just an order.
Sure.
And now it's literally going to David, which is not really
So what I would look forward to is setting up goals and objectives for the year with Richard participating vigorously.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
then we keep to them. And we all agree on them. And then there's some oversight or authority to make sure progress is being made on those goals and objectives.
Okay.
Ultimately,
and
everything's you guys ultimately, but right now we don't really do that as moving forward. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I'm just curious what it is you want us to, I mean, the reality is if you can Google Amherst Act, you know, their television station, you can go and Google all the surrounding TV
well,
stations. And
the advisory board wanted to take bylaws and convert them and make them into what Hadley's would
adapt
be.
Them to Hadley.
Adapt them to Hadley. I
We'd
think
like to
that
do
would,
that.
Would
I think
be
that would be our first,
well, you know,
our first,
policies and
that
procedures.
Would be our, yeah, policies and procedures
and
duties
already,
of
but.
All involved.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Assistants, production manager, and the responsibilities and duties of the committee members.
Right.
But the bottom line is we can't really do that
operating.
Without your consent to go forth and
That's
do that because we are an advisory. We'll walk out as an advisory committee, I think, unless it's something's done
May I make
tonight.
One other,
like to, we're talking about it.
One,
right?
one other comment that Richard actually is very busy. You know, his hours are well spent, and I believe he volunteers a bunch of hours on top of what he's paid for. Typically,
well, I'm not supposed to.
Well, typically,
I don't.
All right, but there's a lot more we could be doing, such as you said, the schools and all the departments should be on the TV, get to know us kind of stuff.
Yeah, police
I don't know half the officers anywhere.
Okay.
In that.
I've got to stop. Just it's getting really late, and we have an executive session. We have.
So I'm trying to get at what is
so
it
I'm
that you want us to do?
I'm going to make a motion that we change the name of the HPAT Advisory Committee to the HPAT Oversight.
It's not on the agenda, so it's a violation of the open meeting.
No, it's not.
It is.
The committee appointment's right there. That we change the. Change the name
but
of the
HPAT. But
it
doesn't say anything about changing the
Changing the name of the HPAT Advisory Committee to an Oversight Committee, and that there's no authority change with that. It's a vernacular change at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
But that if you would then come back to us, and then we would have a discussion about a change in your actual role.
Right.
Okay, and that we would appoint the current members.
Sounds good.
Instead of getting involved in a vote, could we ask our administrator to make a recommendation how he would handle this situation?
Okay, I think
and bring it back to us for a vote?
Well, don't we need the appointments to be done, David?
Yeah, but you have until the next meeting.
I know, I'm just
trying
to avoid
recommendation
that
20 right there.
Okay, can you go over it verbally and discuss it with us so we know what we're talking about?
Here's the select board, the town administrator, cable supervisory committee, under which the station manager and production assistant are assisted by the committee. So directives from the select board go down, issues come back up to the select board if they can't be resolved by the committee or by me.
That's how every committee works, right, under our jurisdiction, so I don't think we're doing anything different.
All it is that it's a different, it's just semantics at this point, but it's like you'll just, I mean, wave the wand, we're there now. It's in that pyramid where we are not at the moment. So I'm still confused. Are we doing that when we walk out? Because there are some things we should be doing as, I mean, I take it seriously, so when I walk out of here, is that my job, or are we still advising?
So I think what I heard is that we're going to change the name of the committee.
Okay.
And we're going to come back at the next meeting, give you all an opportunity to say, okay, what kind of organizational structure is best for the situation we find ourselves in. So it gives you an opportunity to shape this. If not, I'm prepared to make the recommendation that I just showed.
Which you can get to them as well.
Yes, absolutely.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yeah, just thought if you wanted input, it makes sense rather than be.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so there's a motion on the floor?
No second at this point.
Second.
And what is this, to just reappoint them with a new name?
Yep.
But no new charge?
Not at the moment, yep. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Thanks.
Okay.
I'd like to rebut what David Moskin said about my handling the budget. The only year I've had trouble with it is this year because of the change from the way it was to the way it is now, because there was a lot of confusion as to what direction we wanted to go. So I just didn't know what I was supposed to do.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's the first time I've actually had to submit a rigid budget.
Right. Okay. That's fine. Okay. So we all set with that? Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, I think that we're going to, we can all read the town administrator's report. Let's defer the code of conduct and make sure we have adequate time to discuss that in the future. And water abatement?
We need to do the
good.
They're waiting out there, I think, for the water abatement.
Water
abatement. Yeah. Okay. There are people out here.
But that's not what they're here for, Richard. Okay. Yeah, so we need the HVAC controls bid and then the water abatement.
Right. Anyway, so they kept, the HVAC control bid, we received three bids. The low bid is BG Mechanical, $59,945. We have an available budget of $65,160. I make a recommendation based upon the recommendation of the Municipal Building Committee that we award this contract to BG Mechanical.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion on that? Not all in favor?
Aye.
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 Aye. Okay, and then the water abatement?
Water abatement is not recommended by the collector's office or DPW.
Recommend against?
Recommend against.
So moved.
Second.
So moved, seconded. Any further discussion or all in favor?
Aye.
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 Abstain.
Okay. All right. And then that, I believe, do we have any announcements?
I don't.
Yeah, just a couple of real quick one announcements. We have a shredding fair coming up this Friday at 1 p.m., 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. at the Senior Center. There's an opportunity for people to bring their boxes of old documents, and we will shred them for free. This is a good way to prevent identity theft. We have the Ron Baresca Tribute and ALS fundraiser June 12th at the Young Men's Club. We have a debt exclusion ballot vote on June 16th, noon to 8 p.m. Library book sale June 18th at the Cook Memorial Library.
Excellent. Anything else? Okay, if not, do we do have an executive session scheduled tonight. Do we have, I know I have this, but doesn't somebody else have to read something else first?
Okay. So where did Jennifer go?
What
is it here?
Executive session has per positions.
Okay.
Mass General law.
Okay, so go ahead.
The select board will hold an executive session session as per provision of Mass General Law, Chapter 30A, Section 21A1, to discuss the reputation, character, physical condition, or mental health, rather than a professional competence of an individual, or to discuss the discipline or dismissal of complaints, charges, or brought against a public officer, employee, staff member, or individual, police department.
And not to reconvene in an open meeting?
And not to reconvene in an open meeting, my apologies.
Okay, and I'll second that.
Okay, roll call vote. Luskevitz?
Yes.
Devine?
Yes.
Keegan?
Yes.
Chungvo?
Yes.
Kaczynski?
Yes.
Okay.
And then you read.
As the chair, I move that we go forward with a formal disciplinary hearing.
No, that's the wrong one.
That's the wrong one. What am I reading?
This is the one where you, as chair, you... it's been moved and seconded to go into a executive session, and you declare that the items under discussion would be detrimental if discussed in an open meeting.
What you said.
Right.
All right. Okay.
We need that on paper for.
I thought we had it on paper.
Oh, that's okay.
We got the first part in agenda.
Right. So you're in executive session now. Good night, folks.
Okay.
Good night.